So, endangered life species. So, when you talk about endangered life species, so that could be the animals, the plants, anything, the aquatic life, anything which are endangered, that is about to get extinct, on the verge of extinction. Okay, because in the previous lecture we had seen about loss of biodiversity. So, linked to that is the endangered life species topic as well. So, what are the different types of species? The International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources have given us a classification of existing plants and animal kingdom based on their characteristics and the threat they are facing due to human intervention and many other specific factors causing their loss. Okay, so this International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, now they have given the classification of the plants, the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, that depending upon the characteristics, that classification also given by this International Union, as well as the threat they are facing, the threat of extinction that they are facing, that is also given by this International Union. So, depending upon the threat they are facing, the species are again classified into normal species, endangered species, vulnerable species, rare species, endemic species, and extinct species. Okay, so one by one we'll see. What do you mean by normal species? So, species whose population levels are considered to be normal for their survival. So, they are not on the verge of extinction. Normal, the population is normal for their survival, such as the cattle, sow, pine, rodents, etc. Then there are endangered species. So, these are the species which are in the danger of extinction. They are on the verge, on the danger of extinction. The survival of such species is difficult if the negative factors that have led to a decline in their population continue to operate. Because very important phenomena is increase in the temperature. Okay, so that is also one of the negative factor, and if it continues to happen, it will lead to decline on the population of certain species which cannot survive in such high temperature levels. Correct. The examples of endangered species are the black buck, crocodile, etc. Then vulnerable species, these are the species whose population has declined to levels from where it is likely to move into the endanger category in the near future. Okay, I mean, that means the species which are vulnerable, which are prone to move into the endangered category. Okay, so these are the species whose population has declined to levels from where it is likely to move into the endangered category in the near future if the negative factors continue to operate. Similar way, if the negative factor, that is the factors which are responsible for the reduction in their population, if they continue, these are the species which will go into the endangered category, that is vulnerable species. So the examples of such species are the blue sheep, Asiatic elephant, genetic dolphin, etc. Now, these species names, I mean, you don't see it in and around you so frequently, okay? And these names are also many times new to you because they are very rare, okay? And they are now about on the verge of extinction, and that is why we need to save them, correct? Then there are rare species, that is, species with small population may move into the endangered or vulnerable category if the negative factors affecting them continue to operate. Okay, so first is your normal species. The second is the endangered species, which is on the verge of extinction. Then you have the vulnerable species, which are on the verge of going into the endangered category. And then you have the rare species, that is the such species which are on the verge of going into the category of vulnerable or the endangered. Correct. So the examples of such species are the Himalayan brown bear, wild Asiatic buffalo, desert fox, and hornbill, etc. So these are the various diverse types of the animals which are on the verge of going into this endangered or vulnerable category. Then you have endemic species. So these are the species which are only found in some particular areas, usually isolated by natural or geographical barriers. Okay, so they are only found in some particular areas which are isolated by natural and geographical barriers. For example, such species are the Andaman teal, the Nicobar pigeon, the Andaman wild pig, okay, the mitten in the Arunachal Pradesh. Okay, so these are the endemic species which are which are isolated and found in that particular natural barrier only, which can survive in that particular geographical area only. Then you have extinct species. So these are the species which are not found after searches of known or likely areas where they may occur. So that is, they have extinct, they have declined. Okay, a species may be extinct from a local area, region, country, continent, or the entire earth. Okay, so examples of such species are the Asiatic cheetah, the pink-haired duck, and many more. So which the type of species which have extinct. Okay, how does they decline? How does they extinct? Because there are various negative factors going on in and around the whole atmosphere, the whole earth, which is not beneficial for the survival of such species on the earth. Okay. Then, how pollution is affecting the decline of such species? Today, carbon dioxide is coming from our industrial activities and lifestyle. Correct? From every activity, the carbon dioxide gas is emitted. Estimated at the end of the century, and carbon dioxide is a major greenhouse gas, correct? So that is why it, like we had seen in the previous lecture about the greenhouse gases, they are responsible for increasing the temperature of the earth, correct? So estimated that at the end of the century, there will be a 6 degrees Celsius increase in the global temperature if we don't make any changes. Global warming is already affecting the timing of the seasons that we know. Whenever you get this unexpected winter, unexpected rainfall, so all this are everything is linked with the global warming. So global warming is already affecting the timing of the seasons, and animals bearing young earlier than at the beginning of the 20th century. If 95% of the species die out, then humans will be one of them. When you talk about the extinction of the animals, even we are a part of that animal kingdom. And when you talk about the extinction of the animal species, even there will be a time where there will be decline and extinction of the human population as well. Then, so what are the causes, the factors which led to the endangerment or the extinction of the species? That is, the habitat destruction. First of all, the area which is allotted for the species to live for their survival. Okay, that their habitat, their houses, their habitat, the area where they live, that is destructed. So fast pace changes, little or no time for species to react and adjust to new circumstances, because there is such a rapid changes in the in the environment, and be it in the landscaping, be it in the urbanization, be it in the amount of gases in the atmosphere, there is so rapid changes, okay, that the species cannot adjust to the new situation, new circumstances. Now, humans are what caused this destruction. Tropical forests are highly susceptible to destruction. Examples of habitat destruction is clear cutting, destroying by fire, logging, that is for wood logging, the trees are cut, mining, expanding human settlements, and building new towns and cities. Okay, so that is one of the primary cause for species endangerment, that is destruction, specifically this tropical forest destruction. Then every day about 100 species are lost due to deforestation. That's about 27,000 species a year, which we are not aware of and which is not paid attention. Okay, around 100 species are lost due to deforestation every day, and that is about 27,000 species a year. Over half of the Earth's original forests have disappeared. Half of the Earth's original forests have disappeared. Tropical forests contain half of the Earth's species. And 17 million hectares are cleared or burned every year. Okay, the tropical forest areas that we had seen last time. Okay, so there is where it is inhabited for half of the earth species, and 17 million hectares of the tropical forest are cleared or burned every year. Then major urbanization, that is increased habitat loss because of the urbanization, every area is cleared off and some settlement is made for urbanization or industrialization. Okay, and therefore that is a major cause of the habitat loss. Bulldozing, paving, development, etc. for houses, malls, businesses and roads all destroy the habitat. So all this which comes under urbanization, industrialization, they are the major causes where there is habitat loss and therefore the species are lost because of that. Then illegal wildlife trade or over exploitation. So caused by the trade in the animal parts, body parts trade. Okay, so when these species are taken for the trading, use of the species is made for trading, for manufacturing some things, okay, and for you know, for artistic things, for many things the species are used, and therefore for wildlife trade, for international trading, okay, so for therefore that is also one of the cause for loss of the species. So demands for items like rhino horns, walrus tusk, tiger bones in Southeast Asian countries like China. Live animals are taken for the pet trade or their parts exported for medicines or food. Thousands of species equal to part of the illegal international wildlife trade. For example, African or Asian elephants, parrots, rhinos, antelopes causes massive declines in the numbers of many species. So they have declined, the African, Asian elephants, parrots, rhinos, antelopes, all these are facing their decline because of the trading or the over-exploitation for, you know, over-exploitation of the animal parts for making different things. Then global warming and pollution, of course, that we have just seen. Human releasing carbon dioxide, chemicals and greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, which causes the climate change to take place. The warming of the global climate then happens. Pollution affects mainly aquatic species. Chemical causes mutations and fertility problems. Like I said, it's not just the animals, it's not just the plants, it's also about the aquatic life that is affected. In the last lecture of biodiversity, that time also we had seen that how this due to majority the pollution effect is on the aquatic life, because majority of the rivers of our country are polluted and therefore it affects the aquatic life. Correct. Now chemicals causes mutations and fertility problems, and this is mostly seen in the fishes and the polar bears. A chemical commonly found in the shampoos is responsible for causing many fish in the ocean to not reproduce. Fish populations are decreasing as global temperature rise. Many species will be forced into extinction. So global temperature rise also is one of the problem that we know. But along with it, we are polluting the natural water sources. Of course, the air pollution is there, but majorly the pollution effect is on the aquatic life, where most of the rivers are polluted. Like they have given an example also that a chemical which is present in the shampoos, it leads to decline of the fishes, as the fishes in the ocean which is polluted by such contaminants cannot reproduce. Correct. So that is one of the example. Likewise, there might be many things, many other chemicals which are led into the wastewater and into the natural water sources, and which are affecting the decline of the population of the fishes or any other aquatic life. Correct. Then sewage dump, just now what we have seen, that the water pollution. Correct. So sewage dumped in the water affects the fishes, the frogs, etc., all other aquatic life. 50% of the freshwater species population are declining from pollution and pesticides. Global warming puts at least 20-40% of the plant or animal at risk of extinction. See, just now I told you that rise in temperature, that is also the major reason, but it puts 20-40% of the plant and animal species at risk of extinction. But main is the pollution of your freshwater sources, because very hardly any water sources are left which are clean. Otherwise, majority of the water sources are polluted, and therefore it becomes the major cause for loss in the aquatic life. Okay, Then commercial fishing, that is also one of the factor affecting the reduction in the species in of the aquatic life. Okay, so overfishing affects the fish populations and they begin to decrease. About 1,000 whales and dolphins drown every day from getting tangled in the fish gear. Okay, so that is overfishing. That is also declining the fish population. And one example that we have given that when these fishing nets, the fishing gears are used, many other aquatic life gets tangled, like the whales and the dolphins get tangled every day in this fishing gear. Okay, and now just in the news also we see that because of the plastic that is led into the wastewater and then the water sources. This plastic, when it enters into the freshwater sources, be it sea, be it river, or be it any lake, how badly it is affecting the aquatic animal. Okay, so that is also one of the reason. That is majority that comes under the water pollution itself. So that is the major pollution for decline in the species of the aquatic life. So here is a chart showing percent of world endangered animal species threatened by the loss of forest and other natural habitat. So here you could see that how even if this table is of very previous years, but there is such an increase in the extinction of these animal species. See, there are 40 countries with highest percentage of the threatened species. Then how you can help? How you can help from avoiding the extinction decline of this species? We don't want this different species to get declined. Okay, so visit a national park or wildlife reserve and appreciate the animals. Follow the guidelines like the fire regulations. Don't litter and leave the flowers and plants where you find them. Make space for wildlife. Build a birdhouse or have a bird bath, plant a tree, compost your waste, and don't use the harmful chemicals in your home or garden. Because what you are using it, that is going out as waste, and that waste is again going out into the water source or even on the land where the species consume it, come in contact with them, and then gets affected. Recycle, reduce, and reuse. Carpool, take public transportation, walk, ride bikes, that is to reduce the global warming. There are more than 1,000 endangered species worldwide. There are more than 3,500 protected wildlife areas in the world. They cover 5 million square miles or 3% of our total land area. Okay, more than 1,000 endangered species worldwide and more than 3,500 protected wildlife areas in the world. They cover 5 million square miles or 3% of our total land area. More than 16,000 of the world's mammals, birds, and plants are threatened with extinction. One fourth of the known 5,487 wild mammal species on the planet are threatened with extinction. That's 1,372 mammals almost gone from the face of the earth. Most species in the world will become extinct before they are even known to man. Of course, that is what is happening. We are not even aware of what is the biodiversity present in our country or in the world. We are not even aware of the various types of the species. And till then we know them, till the time that we know them, they are extinct. 12% of all the birds, 33% of amphibians, and 50% of the palm trees are threatened with extinction. Climate change alone could lead to further extinction of 15 to 37% of species by the end of the century. Between 1960 and 2000, human population of the world has doubled, but the animal population has declined by 30%. So as there is increase, there is no decrease in the human population. There is always an increase in the human population, and it is increasing year by year. But there have been decrease in the various species of the animals, in the various species of the plants as well. Okay, 137 species are estimated to go extinct each day. 50,000 species are estimated to go extinct each year. 95% of the known plant species have not yet been screened for their medicinal values. There are, when you talk about, now when you talk about plants, okay, there are animals, you know, and now we talk about plants. There are so diverse variety of the plants which have a lot of medicinal values also. So we need to conserve such plants that, because they are of huge benefit to us, not just for us, for the whole world. Okay, so there are many plants which have medicinal values which are very useful, but they are also getting declined. Why save endangered species? They must be protected and saved so that future generations can experience their values. They have medicinal values. Plants and animals are responsible for many useful medicines. 40% of all the prescriptions written today are made from natural compounds from different species. 40% of all the prescription of all the medicines or whatever required to be taken, okay, that is made from the natural compound that comes from different species. These species help save life and contribute to pharmaceutical industry. So they are responsible for the pharmaceutical industry as well. Some species could have important compounds needed for medicine, but because they are disappearing so fast, so we will never be able to find. We will never be able to find them. Okay. More than 3 million heart disease sufferers would die within 72 hours of a heart attack without a drug for the purple from the purple foxglove. Okay. So that is also the drug, that is the medicine from the purple foxglove, and which is useful, that serves as a medicine for the heart disease patients. Then 80,000 edible plants in the world. 80,000 edible plants in the world. Humans depend on 20 species of this, like corn, wheat, etc., to provide 90% of the world's food. Okay, so they have the agriculture values. There are 80,000 edible plants. Okay, and if there is decline in this, there will be no we won't get the sufficient amount of food, correct? Then ecological benefit, that is for ecology, why we need to save these species. First was they must be protected so that the future generation can experience their value. Then they have medicinal values, then they have agriculture values, and then they have this ecological value. That is, the plant and the animal species are the foundation of the healthy ecosystem. Humans depend on ecosystem like prairie grasslands and the ancient forest to supply us with food and purify the air. Very important. When species become endangered, it means the ecosystem is not healthy. Correct? So that is why we need to save the species, the variety of the species that we are not even aware of, but they are present, but they are on the verge of extinction, but we need to conserve them. Okay. So, like they have just shown us that how important it is for the medicinal values. One example what they have given, that more than 3 million heart disease sufferers would die within 72 hours of heart attack without a drug from the purple foxglove. You just see purple foxglove is a plant. It's a purple color plant, purple color flower plant. Okay, so that hardly you could see it nearby, hardly. I don't think so we will see it nearby to you, because they have also started those plants, those flowers, the purple flower plant, that has also started getting extinct. Okay, so one of the example where this drug is so important for a major type of disease. Similarly, a lot more of the plants species are responsible for various medicinal drugs. Okay, agriculture value, you know it, how important it is for food, and ecological balance. For ecological balance, we need to conserve these species. These are few of the photos of the endangered animals. Learn as much as you can about the endangered species in your area. Visit a nearby national wildlife refuge or nature center. Volunteer to help. Don't buy species illegally taken from the wild, and don't buy the products made from threatened or endangered species. Never, never buy products which are made from this endangered species. Okay, because most of the people just for the artistic value, just for the aesthetic point of view, just for looking good, just for the decorating their houses. When you buy some product, do make sure that it is not made from the threatened or the endangered species. The most hope for endangered species lies in the hands of young people like you who care enough to make.
You can probably name quite a few endangered species. Polar bear, blue whale, and black rhino are just a few. But there are many more that don't get so much attention. There are currently around 16,500 animals and plants that are endangered. An endangered species is one that is at a high risk of becoming extinct, which is when there are no longer any members of that species alive. Lots of species are going extinct every single day. Sometimes this is because of natural causes. Extinction is part of evolution after all. But many more because of human activity. In fact, because of humans, the rate of extinction is estimated to be 1,000 to 10,000 times higher than what would occur naturally. This is the highest rate since the extinction of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago. Conservation is the act of protecting species against becoming endangered. It's all about preserving biodiversity. If you want to learn more about biodiversity and why it matters, watch this video. You might wonder why it's such a big deal. Why does it matter if the population of a species decreases so much that it is endangered? Surely, if there are a few individuals, such as those in zoos, then a species can recover. The problem is that the key to having a healthy population is genetic variation. Within a population, you need a large variety of different characteristics so that a species can adapt if there is a change in the environment and avoid becoming extinct. This can happen if all the members of the species have similar genes. Also, in a small population, there is a high chance of inbreeding, where closely related individuals breed. This can increase the risk of offspring having inherited conditions. So large wild populations are important for a species' survival. There are many reasons why a species might become endangered. It can happen because of habitat destruction, climate change, overfishing or hunting, and the introduction of invasive species to habitats which outcompete the native ones. We have an ethical duty to help preserve all the species on Earth, and this is done by carrying out conservation. Let's look at a few methods used. Firstly, endangered animals can be housed in wildlife parks. This protects them. And also captive breeding programs can be used to increase their numbers. They help educate people about conservation and how we can all help protect endangered species. They also help the general public to form an emotional connection to these endangered species. However, there are disadvantages to animals in captivity. The animals do not lead a normal life, and there is risk of inbreeding. A way of protecting animals in their natural habitat is by creating protected areas like national parks. Trees cannot be cut down, roads and houses can't be built, and hunting of the animals is illegal. Rangers are employed to make sure this is enforced. It's not just animals, plants are also at risk. An amazing 70% of plant species are endangered, so it's vital that we help protect them too. As well as using protected areas, plants that are endangered are preserved by collecting seeds and storing them in seed banks. If a plant does become extinct, the seeds can be grown to restore their populations. To recap, an endangered species is one that is at risk from extinction, the main causes of which are human activities. Protecting vulnerable species is called conservation, and there are many methods to do so, including wildlife parks and protected areas.
The risk or danger to human health or environment posed by radiation emanating from the atomic nuclei of a given substance, because in the name itself, you know, the nuclear hazards, correct? So the radiation emanating from atomic nuclei of a given substance, or the possibility of an uncontrolled explosion originating from a fusion or fission reaction of the atomic nuclei. That is the nuclear hazard. So when you talk about nuclear hazard, it is a risk or danger to the human health or the environment posed by the radiation. Correct? They're posed by the radiation emanating from the atomic nuclei of a given substance, or the possibility of uncontrolled explosion originating from a fusion or fission reactions of the atomic nuclei. Radioactive pollution is a special type of physical pollution which is related to all the major life supporting systems like air, water, soil, etc. That is the radioactive pollution. So when you talk about nuclear hazards or the radioactive pollution, it's one and the same. Okay, that is the hazard or the pollution or the effect because of the radiations from the atomic nuclei of certain hazardous substances. Okay, certain radioactive elements. So radioactive or nuclear pollution is a special form of physical pollution related to all major life supporting systems like air, water, soil, etc. That is, they are affecting everything. Radioactivity is the phenomenon of emission of energy from radioactive isotopes, which are unstable isotopes, such as, so radioactive elements, you know, radioactive isotopes, that is carbon-14, uranium-235, uranium-238, uranium-239, radium-226, etc. So in the periodic table, these isotopes, from that you can make out which are the radioactive isotopes. The emission of energy from radioactive substances in the environment is often called as the radioactive pollution. Okay, so these radioactive substances, radioactive isotopes, which may undergo fusion or fission reactions. Okay, so the radiations that they emit, the energy that they emit, that is called they are the radiation, and the effect is, the radioactive pollution is effect of that radiation. Generally, radiation hazards in the environment comes from the UV rays, from the cosmic rays, visible or microwave radiation. Among these X-rays, which produce out 95% of the radiation exposure. Nuclear energy, that is the power plants, is used to produce electricity, but fuel used in power plant is radioactive, which is very dangerous, and waste materials are hazardous. So these are the various sources from where this radioactive elements are emitted, or the radiations are emitted, correct? The nuclear waste materials also emit radiation, that is the radioactive pollution. Generally, radiation exposure is measured by the unit called Roentgen, that is R. One Roentgen is defined as the quantity of radiation which produces 1.6 into 1012 pairs of ions in 1 gram of air. So that is such a high value when you call 1 R, that is 1 Roentgen. So what are the different sources of the nuclear hazards? That is, now just we had seen the natural resources, that is the cosmic rays from the outer space. The quantity depends on altitude and latitude. It is more at higher latitude and the higher altitudes. Emission from the radioactive materials from the Earth's crust. Okay, so these are the natural resources from where the nuclear these radiations could be produced, correct? Then the man-made sources are the nuclear power plant. Just we had seen that the fuel, the substance which is used as fuel in the nuclear power plant, okay? So that produces the radiations, X-rays, nuclear bombs, nuclear accidents, mining and processing of radioactive ores, use of radioactive materials in the nuclear weapons. Okay, so these are the sources, the man-made sources from which the nuclear radiations are emitted and nuclear hazards occur. Okay, or the nuclear, you know, the radioactive substances are emitted into the atmosphere. Okay, so that is also because of the man-made sources, and which will cause nuclear hazards. So what are the effects? Like you know, when there was when there was a Chernobyl disaster or the Bhopal gas tragedy, okay, so that time also when the that is also one of the nuclear hazard, and the effect the scope of the effect was too much, too high, correct? Because people were exposed to such gases, such radiations. Okay, so effect are the biological effects of the nuclear radiation that can be divided into three groups. Short-term recoverable effects, that is a small effect which lead to loss of hair, and long-term irrecoverable effects and the genetic defect. So when you talk about effect of such, because they are, the effect of such nuclear radiation is very dangerous and the scope is also very large. It's not the small simple effects that is caused. So biological effects can be divided as the short-term recoverable effects, the long-term irrecoverable effects, and the genetic effect. Internal bleeding and the blood vessel damage may show up as red spots on the skin. Cancer is considered to be a major health problem from the radiation exposure. Radiation can cause changes in the DNA, which is known as mutation. Acute exposures appears as burns and radiation sickness, that is nausea, hair loss, weaknesses, etc. So these are the various things which are not in the small or the neglected effects. Okay, this, the effect of the nuclear radiation is too high and too critical. So now, just now we have seen that the radiation, the level of the radiation is measured as in the unit of Roentgen, that is R. So when you talk about 0 to 50 R of radiation, okay, so what is the effect? No visible effect. So when the radiation, when the nuclear, when the radioactive isotopes are emitting the radiation level of 0 to 50 R level, that time there will be no visible effect. That is, no effect is caused. Sorry. But 50 to 200 R, if the level of the radiation is 50 to 200 R, brief periods of nausea on day of exposure, 50% may experience radiation sickness, that is nausea or vomiting, 5% may require medical attention, no death are expected. Okay, when you go higher level of radiation, that is 200 to 450 R, most members of the group will require medical attention because of the serious radiation sickness, 50% deaths within 2 to 4 weeks. Okay, that is when you go at the higher, when the radiation is of higher level, 200 to 50 R. Again, if the radiation level is more than that, 450 to 600 R, serious radiation sickness in all members of the group, medical attention required, death to more than 50% within 1 or 2, 3 weeks. Okay, and when you talk about 600 R and above, severe radiation sickness, 100 deaths in 2 weeks, and many other health effects. Okay, so what are the control measures in order to reduce such radiation from the from this radioactive elements? Leakages from the nuclear reactors, which has happened in the Bhopal gas tragedy, which has happened in the Chernobyl disaster. Leakages from the nuclear reactors, careless handling, transport and use of radioactive fuels, fusion products and radioactive isotopes have to be totally stopped. Safety measures should be enforced strictly. Waste disposal must be very careful, efficient and effective. There should be regular monitoring and quantitative analysis through frequent sampling in the risk areas. Preventive measures should be followed so that background radiation levels do not exceed the permissible limit. Appropriate steps should be taken against the occupational exposure, and safety measures should be strengthened against the nuclear accident. And therefore, nowadays, very, very few that you can count on your fingers, such nuclear reactors are only present worldwide, because use of such reactors is avoided now. Then, the nuclear waste which is generated, how the disposal could be done? When there is high level of waste, there is high level waste have high radioactivity per unit volume. Since these wastes are too dangerous to be released anywhere in the biosphere, therefore they are must be contained either by converting them into the inert solid, that is the ceramic, and then deep buried into the earth or stored in the deep salt mines. So what is done to dispose? Since this radioactive elements cannot be disposed directly on the earth, okay, what is done? They are mixed with the ceramic. They are enclosed, or you could say the elements are enclosed in the inert solid like the ceramic. so that they should not leach out, they should not leak out. Okay, leaching should not happen, leakage should not happen. Okay, and they should not come out and get exposed into the atmosphere. So they are enclosed into ceramic. Okay, and then buried deep in the earth or stored deep in the salt mines. Then when you have medium level waste, that is medium level waste, example, the filters, the reactive components, etc., are solidified and mixed with concrete in steel drums before being buried in deep mines or below the seabed in the concrete chambers. So same way where this type of waste was enclosed into the inner solid, similarly this medium level waste is also enclosed, mixed in the concrete, so it becomes hardened. Okay, it becomes hardened, it encloses it, the radioactive waste, correct, and from the concrete it cannot then leach out, correct, therefore they are solidified. Okay, the waste is solidified and mixed with the concrete in the steel drums, and then they, before being deep buried, in the sense that is also deep buried, buried deep in the mines or below the seabed in the concrete chambers. Okay, then you have low liquid waste, where low liquid waste, example, solids or liquids contaminated with the traces of radioactivity are disposed of in steel drums in concrete lined trenches in the design sites. Okay, so there is no specific, because this radioactive waste cannot disappear, they don't degrade, they don't get recycled. Okay, so if they are supposed to be disposed of, how it is disposed of, it should be disposed of in such a way that they do not leak out into the atmosphere. They are solidified, they are enclosed into such substances like concrete or the ceramic, that they get hardened and they cannot move and they don't get removed from it and get exposed into the atmosphere, and then they are deep buried into the earth's crust or at the bottom, at the seabed bottom or in the deep mines, they are buried. So that is actually, there is no treatment given. It is just the disposal point of view. There is no treatment given to such, cannot be given to such type of the waste. And therefore, use of such radioactive elements, use of these nuclear reactors which emit the nuclear radiations, such nuclear weapons, nuclear explosives, okay, all these things have to be reduced. And because their effect is also too large and their disposal is also a major problem. So what safety measures could be followed? Monitoring the radioactivity around the disposal site, prevention of erosion of the radioactivity disposal site. So you have hazardous waste disposal site or radioactive disposal site as well. Like in Mumbai, you have Taloja, where you have the hazardous waste disposal site. Prevention of any drilling activity in and around the waste disposal site. Periodic and long-term monitoring of such disposal sites and areas of naturally occurring uranium-rich rocks. Those are the safety measures. Now I'll just show you the various examples of how these nuclear hazards have occurred. There are many incidents where nuclear hazards have occurred. Few of the incidents I'll just show you.
If you've been paying attention at all to the internet lately, you've probably heard of HBO's miniseries titled Chernobyl. Of course, the show is named after the infamous nuclear disaster in 1986. The show's popularity has led to many discussions about nuclear energy and, more specifically, what can go wrong with nuclear reactors. It's important to note that nuclear energy will likely continue to play a key role in humanity's transition to renewable energy. And over the last few decades, scientists and engineers have become much better at refining nuclear energy reactors and processes. Still, there's no denying that mistakes have been made along the way. So, here's a list of five of the worst nuclear power plant accidents to date. Just like with earthquakes, hurricanes, and tsunamis, the severity of nuclear reactor accidents and incidents are measured on a scale. This scale is called the International Nuclear and Radiological Event Scale, or INES. We'll be referencing this scale as we go to help us organize our list.
So
Starting off, we have the Japanese Miyama nuclear power plant incident from August 9th of 2004. This event only ranks at a 1 out of 7 on the INES, which isn't surprising when you consider the incident didn't actually involve any of the nuclear components of the power plant. Instead, a broken pipe began to leak steam and hot water, killing 5 workers. In January of 1961, the only fatal incident involving a nuclear reactor on U.S. soil occurred. The National Reactor Testing Station in Idaho Falls experienced an explosion in its SL-1 reactor when a control rod was pulled too far away from the reactor. All 3 people working on the reactor were killed in the explosion, and due to radioactive contamination, had to be buried in lead coffins. This incident received a rank of 3 out of 7 on the INES. In 1997, Japan experienced another nuclear accident. A small explosion at a nuclear reactor in Tokemura required workers to patch broken windows and doors. As a consequence, they were exposed to unhealthy levels of radiation. Just 2 years later, in 1999, another incident would happen. Only this one would be more serious. A group of workers made an error while preparing fuel for a nuclear reactor. While they were preparing the fuel, a fission chain reaction occurred, sending radiation coursing through the bodies of the workers, killing 2 of them directly. The accident was rated a 4 on the INES. On March 11th of 2011, a magnitude 9 earthquake off the coast of Japan caused a tsunami to flood the Fukushima nuclear reactor. The generators needed to cool the reactors were flooded, leading to meltdowns, explosions, and the release of radioactive material. 2 employees died during the flooding, and many experienced varying effects from the radioactive material, ranging from nuclear burns to cancer. The radiation from this accident contaminated the local ecosystem and even found its way into the ocean. Because of the scope of its damage, the Fukushima accident was given a 7 on the INES, which is the highest possible rank. It is also one of only 2 accidents to receive this rank. Finally, on April 26th of 1986, the most infamous nuclear accident occurred when a scheduled safety test went horribly wrong. During the test, nearly all of the control rods in Chernobyl's reactor number 4 malfunctioned, leading to rapid overheating in the reactor. Eventually, a nuclear meltdown occurred and the reactor exploded. 8 tons of radioactive debris were launched into the atmosphere, and over 115,000 people were evacuated from the area. In just a matter of days, over 31 first responders died because of their exposure to the radiation. A massive concrete shell was placed over the destroyed reactor at the time, but now a more stable structure, known as the Chernobyl Arch, rests over the reactor to shield the surrounding area from the 200 tons of radioactive material that still rests inside. So, there you have it. Keep in mind that these death tolls should be taken with a grain of salt. It's incredibly difficult to accurately measure the death tolls of nuclear accidents because the effects may not manifest until later in life. While these accidents were tragic, nuclear energy is, for the most part, pretty safe. Perhaps one day we will master the art of nuclear fusion and we'll be able to finally put these fission-based accidents behind us.